everybody, and welcome to Church Online. We are so excited that you tuned in today because God has something so special for you. Please like and share this message because it could be the very thing, the very word that God has to transform your life and someone else's. So prepare your hearts for what God has today.
I'm thrilled to be able to be here, and I told your pastor, I said, if you don't mind, I'm going to preach something with a Christmas theme, because for 48 years on this Sunday, I preached something about the Christmas story, or 46 years, and now I don't get that opportunity to preach on this Sunday hardly at all anymore, so this is a special thrill to me, and I'm just excited to be here, and I will tell you for sure, I feel the presence of the Lord. You know, when I was a young boy growing up, Laverne Tripp, I think it was, old gospel singer, wrote a song that said, when he saved me, he gave me something I can feel. And I know Christianity is not all about the feeling, but if you read Paul's writings, he talks about to know him, and when he puts those words down, it literally has the connotation of to know him experientially. I know Joe Biden. I know Donald Trump. I know Barack Obama, but I don't know them. I mean, if they walked in today, I would recognize them, but they don't know me. And hey, I can say I know them, but I don't know them. But I'll tell you about Jesus. I know him because I've experienced him. I was introduced to him about 62 or 63 years ago. I found Jesus to be Lord and Savior of my life, and I know him. And he walks with me, and he talks with me. And I think it's one of the most spiritual things we can do is talk about the Christmas story. So I want to read scriptures that we've already seen on the screen or heard this morning, but I want to read them again. Matthew 1 and 18 simply says this, now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother Mary was betrothed to Joseph, before they came together, before they cohabited, before they lived together as man and wife, she was found of child, not by another man, but by the Holy Ghost. Somebody said, how did that happen? I don't know. Well, if you can't explain it, it's not real. I can't explain how a black cow eats green grass and gives white milk. But I sure do enjoy it. Now, let me read you another scripture. It's already been read today. Luke 2 and 12. Let me see here. And this will be a sign to you. I thought they did a great job on that little vignette while ago. You shall find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger. Father, we thank you for this privilege to preach the gospel. I've done this 4,000 to 5,000 times. I still tremble sometimes inside when I think of the awesomeness and the responsibility that's placed upon me to preach to never-dying people, the never-changing gospel of the eternal God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Please help me to say succinctly what needs to be said, clearly, with passion, with the respect for the God that I serve, the people that I'm serving, and the pastor that I'm representing today. Would you use me and touch me, I pray, in Jesus' name. And everybody said, I want to preach to you this morning on what Jesus came to be. Three words, light, hope, and Lord. The Christmas story is a beautiful story. And again, the little vignette a while ago, the little girl and the tremendous actor, because the joy that was in her face as she talked about this baby. We've seen it over and over again. I used to, at one church where I pastored, I took the night before Christmas and I found another version of it and I reworked it myself and I put the night before Jesus came and I read it and I sat down on the floor and I bet we had, 40 kids there that morning and I sat around them and I read the night before Jesus came. And it was just a fascinating little event and to see the thrill in their eyes. And then I did something that, well, I guess you'd think was silly, but I found online one of the childhood toys that I loved. It was a Toy Joy Gyro. Anybody ever even heard of that? That's before all of y'all's time. It was a gyroscope, and you could wind it up with a string and pull that centerpiece, and you could balance it on your finger. A gyro is what keeps planes from turning over and stuff. And it was amazing. I took it and put it on top of my bald head, you know, and just let it spin around and around. And the kids, the amazement that there is around Christmas cannot be reproduced by Easter bunnies or any other things that we've associated and brought into the holy days that we now call holidays. You just can't do it. Every heart's been touched by that probably most famous of all Christmas carols, Silent Night, Holy Night. All is calm, all is bright. Round yon virgin, one boy was in school, and you know how when I grew up hearing songs, I heard Creedence Clearwater sing, "There's a bad moon on the rise." I thought they were saying there's a bathroom on the right. So he heard him saying, "Round yon virgin." He went home singing it, and he sang, "Round yon virgin." Well, that's not the way it goes, but it's a story, holy and tender and mild, sleeping, heavenly peace. But it's more than a beautiful story. It's the single most significant event in the world up to that time. And it's only rivaled by one other event, and that's the death and the crucifixion and the resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. What that Christmas story was, and you see, I find that the Bible and all these characters, and I started to preach about all them characters, and I thought about how long I preached last week, and I said, I better not do that again. I might never get invited back. But every character around Christmas speaks about somebody today. What the Christmas story was, it still is. It is a message. It's not a story. It's a message. It's a message that a dark and a hopeless and a rebellious world needed to hear, and that a dark, hopeless, rebellious world needs to hear. A dark world needs light. A hopeless world needs hope. And a rebellious world needs a Lord and a Master. So let me preach those three things to you real quickly today. Jesus came to be the light of the world. In Matthew 2:2, the Bible said, "There came wise men from the east, saying, 'Where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him.'" Again, when you say the word Christmas, you're literally saying Christ Mass. And I know I'm not Catholic. I didn't grow up Catholic. I have no reason to be Catholic. And I'm not against anybody. If that's the way you want to go that way. But we take the word Mass, and it really just meant the worship time. So Christmas, when they say Merry Christmas, they're saying worship the Christ. Maybe that's the reason the world hates it so bad now. They want us to move to Happy Holidays. And look, when I grew up, we said Happy Holidays quite a bit, but we didn't do it under the connotation of replacing Merry Christmas. So I'm very adamant myself. Merry Christmas or worship the Christ. That's what we're talking about when we say that. Worship the Christ. That's what we're here for today. It's not about me. It's not about you. It's not about your pastor. It's about worshiping the one who is worthy to be exalted, a name that is above every name. This was a dark world of superstition and ignorance the night that the star shined over Bethlehem. And let me go ahead and clarify this. We don't believe, I don't, that the wise men actually made it to the manger. You read in the Luke that the Bible said when they came into the house, it could have been a week later, 6 weeks. It could have been as much as 2 years later. I don't know. But I know the light shined in Bethlehem, and the world has been trying to figure out everything they could to explain it. Somebody said, well, two planets came together. I don't know if they did. I just know this one thing, that whenever it happened, it was in the fullness of time. For the Bible said, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his Son into the world, made under the law, made of a woman, that he might redeem people like you and me who are under the law. And he put a light in the sky because he wanted the world to know that the darkness is about to come to an end. You see, there is no such thing as darkness. Darkness doesn't exist. It's only the absence of light. Cold doesn't exist. It's just the absence of heat. You say, you can't prove that. Science has already proved it. There is an absolute cold when it reaches 468 degrees centigrade, below zero, that's just, it can't get no colder, but fire can get hotter and hotter and hotter. So there is no cold, only the absence of heat. There is no darkness, only the absence of light. So the world was in darkness because the light had not yet been revealed to this world. But there it was, glowing in a little manger that night. So you see, men, and it's amazing. I watched the story of Ruth last night. And when we were looking for Christmas stuff, and I had taped this. And I didn't tell my wife while I was watching this. But it made me think of something that I wanted to tell you today. At that day, and for hundreds of years prior, men worshiped gods that weren't real. They bowed down to idols of wood and stone and metal. I don't know if you noticed, but when you read a lot in Isaiah and some of the other prophets, God is continually making fun of people who go down and cut a tree down, and they take part of the wood and make a chair. They take part of the wood of that tree and use fire to cook their food, and then they take the other piece of it and carve it, cover it in metal, and call it their god. Now, how stupid can you be? The same stuff that I'm cooking my cornbread on is the same stuff I'm going to bow down and worship. I don't believe that's the way it ought to go. But I was watching it last night, and they were talking on Ruth, the story of Ruth about Chemosh, and I saw him. And it was amazing to me. He was this fat, pot-bellied god, looked a lot like Buddha, but he wasn't. But he had a hole in his stomach, and they had a fire burning there. And this was the worship of so many of the nations that surrounded Israel, of Chemosh and of Molech. And I got news for you, and I don't want to get political in your church, and if you want to stop me right here, just stop me. But what we're seeing today is a revival of the worship of Molech and Chemosh in the sacrificing of the unborn children of this world through this horrible thing that's called abortion. Now, if you've had an abortion, I've got good news to tell you. God forgives. But I watched that thing, and what they would do is they would take their little babies and they would put them in that fire, in that belly of Chemosh, and roast them. And while they did that, they beat drums very loudly so that the parents could not hear the screams of their children as they roasted in the belly of Moloch and of Chemosh. And that's the kind of world that Jesus Christ came into. You see, I found out I've got a microwave. Anybody got a microwave? You know what? It'll burn your bread up before you can do it. It'll melt the icing on your cupcake when you just want to get it a little bit warm. But you know, there's something about a microwave. It may produce heat, but it gives no warmth, and it gives no light. That's what the world has. Jesus Christ came to bring a fire that would bring light and warmth into our lives. They were sacrificing children on fires that could give them no light. But all it could do was deepen the darkness of their soul. It is then of no small significance that the birth of Jesus was announced to those outside of Israel by the appearance of a star. You see, way back in the book of Numbers, we have the Balaam beginning to prophesy. He was hired. They tried to hire him to curse Israel, but God said... And Balaam went on to say, how can you curse what God has blessed? But listen to what he said. I shall see him, but not now. I shall behold him, but not near. There shall come a star out of Jacob, and a scepter shall rise out of Israel, and shall smite the corners of Moab. That's where Chemosh was. And destroy all the children of Sheth, which literally translates to means the enemies of Israel. That prophecy was made by Balaam. He was not an Israelite. And its fulfillment was recognized by Magi from the east, most likely from Persia. You say, where did they hear that from? I can tell you where. There was a faithful man in Persia who was in captivity, whose name was Daniel, who worshiped God and prayed every morning, every noon, and night. There were three boys by the name of Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, or Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who wouldn't bend and who wouldn't bow, and because of their faith wouldn't burn. And the story had been told in the east about the coming and the rising of a star. And when they saw the star, I love the song, and when they saw the star, they rejoiced with great joy. They rejoiced with exceeding great joy. joy. It's time for the church to get happy about Jesus again. Don't worry about the inflation. I don't like it. Yeah, I went through a special way so I could come by one of the cheaper stations in Savannah because it's cheaper here than it is in Brunswick. And I went that way to get some gas. I don't like the fact that hamburger meat cost me $7.99, and that's because it had then started turning dark. But if you think I'm going to sit awake at night and mully grub and groan, oh no, I'm not going to live in the darkness of this mess that we find ourselves in. I'm going to walk in the light of the star that shone that night that still arises to shine in our lives today. Now, there's an interesting prophecy in Isaiah. And now, the Lord says, who formed me from the womb to be his servant. You say, I'm an Old Testament preacher. I love the New Testament, but I love the Old because it tells me that everything that's in the New is the truth. It's real. I see the prophecies of Jesus here. Now says the Lord who formed me from the womb to be a servant, to bring Jacob back to him so that Israel is gathered to him. I shall be glorious in the eyes of the Lord, and my God shall be my strength. Indeed, he says, is it too small a thing that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and to restore the preserved ones of Israel? I will also give you as a light to the Gentiles. Yeah, I would think I'm probably sitting in a room full of Gentiles today. If we got any Messianic Jews here, praise God for you. But probably most of us are Gentiles. And thank God when Jesus came, he didn't leave us out. He sent a light over into the most hateful and ungodly place in the world, Persia. That's Babylonia. That's that been one of the enemies of Israel from the very start. But that's where the light, they saw the light over in Persia. The Gentiles recognized it, that you should be my salvation to the ends of the earth. Now listen, this is so important to me. Thus says the Lord, the Redeemer of Israel, the Holy One, to him whom man despises. We know he was despised and rejected, right? To him who the nations abhor. If you read the book of Psalms, they say, what do we have to do with you? Leave us alone. They hate him. And they hate him today, by the way. We don't have a war on religion in America. We have a war on Jesus. We don't have a war on holidays. We have a war on worship the Christ. Good preaching, preacher. Here's what it says. To the servant of rulers, listen to this. Kings shall arise, and princes also shall worship because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, and he has chosen you. I see messianic prophecies there. I see where it says the Lord formed me from the womb. That's the virgin birth, and I got news for you. You can't go to heaven without the virgin birth. It's not a debatable thing. It is the law of God. Christ was born of a virgin. He did not carry the sinful blood of Adam in his body. His blood formed entirely from the union of whatever the Holy Spirit did in the womb of a woman. And the blood that feeds that baby, that comes from the mother, that passes through the umbilical cord and goes into that baby's body, it does not remain there. There was not one taint of Adam's blood inside of Jesus Christ. He was born of the virgin. That don't make Mary anything more than you and me. It makes her a vessel of God, and you can be a vessel just like she was a vessel. But you read it on. He says, I see him as a light to the Gentiles. That means the ministry didn't come for a little tiny nation at the crest and the bend of the Mediterranean Sea. No, he said a light to the Gentiles. That brings me back to Children's Church, red and yellow, black and white. They are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the little children of the world, and he loves you. But then I read this. It said, kings shall arise, and princes shall come and worship. Maybe it's not specifically talking about this, but when I read that, the thing that hit me was, we three kings of Orient are, bearing gifts we traverse afar, field and fountain, moor and mountain, following yonder star. And I'm not going to sing the rest of it because it gets a little hard to sing. I grew up singing Christmas music. I love to go to church. It still sings it. But we used to sing, oh, beautiful star, the hope of rest, for the redeemed, the good and blessed. Beautiful star of Bethlehem, shine on. Well, the Bible said that these kings and priests and rulers and whatever they were, they came and they didn't throw their stuff in and say, see you later. We didn't come to a manger or we didn't come to this little tiny house. No. They came in and bowed and gave him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh, and bowed their heads to worship him. I believe the words of Isaiah were fulfilled when Balthazar and all these other three, and there's actually, the legend says there was actually four wise men. One was detained and never got to give his gift to the Christ. But legend says that as he was still searching for him at his crucifixion, he gave away the pearl that he had brought to some man in great need. And then he felt the convincing Spirit of God in his life that said, inasmuch as you have done it unto one of the least of these, my brethren, you've done it unto me. They brought him gold, frankincense, and myrrh. You say, why? Well, gold's the gift of king. Frankincense is the anointing of the priest. And myrrh is the burial thing. But also they brought him enough money because Jesus wasn't going to be able to stay there. My God supplies needs. He supplied the need of his own son. He sent enough gold, enough frankincense and myrrh so that they could sell that and they could take him down to Egypt and live until Herod was gone and bring him back to fulfill his ministry. He still makes a way where there seems to be no way. I don't have time to preach that. Isaiah 9:2 said, the people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. And they that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them the light hath shined. John said it this way. In him was life. And the life was the light of men. And the light shined in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. That doesn't mean the darkness didn't understand. That means when you turn the light on, the darkness has to flee. And what we need is a revelation of light. I was praying one time, cutting the grass down in Florida. I was praying. I said, oh God, give us light. He said, light's not the problem. I said, the world's in darkness. He said, the world's in blindness. The light's already shining. God, help us to break the shackles off of people and to lift the cataracts off of their eyes that they can see the light of Jesus Christ. He came to be a light, but the message doesn't stop with light. He came to be hope. I don't have time to read all of this to you today, but you know the story. They're in the manger. They're there, the cattle are lowing, the sheep are bleeding, the donkeys are braying, and everything else. I don't know what camels do, but whatever they do, they were probably doing it there too. But the Bible said there were shepherds in the field. And let me read you that. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them. And the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. Southern, that would be they were sure afraid. The angel said, don't be afraid. I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You'll find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly, there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace and goodwill toward men. And don't let me bust your bubble here. But all of my life, I've always thought the angel sang that. And I got to looking. It never, ever intimates that they sang that song. We preached it. I heard it preached in my church the last time I was there. Oh, the angels were singing. I don't know if they were or not. Because I read that several hundreds and thousands of years before this, the song leader got kicked out of heaven. And he brought his choir down with him. Lucifer was the worship leader of heaven. And the only thing you'll read about singing in heaven after Lucifer's kicked out is God sings over us. The one reason he hates us is because we have the gift that he gave up. Now, angels may have sung that night, and if they did, I'm sure it was a beautiful song. But the greatest song is not the song of the angels. It's the song of the redeemed. When they sing, light of the star, keep on shining, lead us to the light of the world. When they begin to sing, Jesus is your ticket to heaven. Well, you never even heard that, have you? They sung that when I was a boy, too. All kind of silly things y'all would laugh at today. We sung, but all we were doing was tell the world, Jesus is not just a baby. He's not just there. He came to bring hope to that generation. But he brings a hope that this generation needs today. Let me tell you about shepherds. They went and they were excited. They saw it and they said, let us return in haste and tell what's been done. But you know, something you need to know about shepherds. They were a pretty hopeless lot. They were the lowest classed citizens in Israel. I've always struggled with this. Their word was considered unusable and unreliable. The Sanhedrin was the ruling council, but a shepherd could not come in and give a testimony to the Sanhedrin because they were so low-classed that their word was considered untrue and unreliable. The angels found the most unlikely heralds of the story to tell, and to them they told it. They went back telling everybody, and I can almost see people saying, you can't believe a word they said. Do you believe those shepherds? They smell like sheep. You can't believe a word they say, but oh, I got news for you. When I read in the New Testament about people like me and you, it says not many mighty, not many noble, not many of high birth were called, but you and I were called. I was just a little country boy from the hills of Mississippi. And I don't know why, but one day in a service at the Ackerman Church of God, the Holy Spirit came into that thing and touched my heart. I knew God was dealing with me. I'd preached many times before this, but I had no call to preach. I didn't have it. It wasn't there. But that morning he spoke to me, and he picked me up out of those hills, and I've been around this world. I've had the opportunity to share the gospel to Muslims in Bulgaria who have never heard Jesus Christ ever preached. I preached in more places than I can tell you about. And let me tell you, this message is not something to be heralded with lights and a microphone. Its ministry is where wherever you find it. I was on the phone with Southwest just this week trying to get some money that we bought tickets for our General Assembly last year, and we didn't go. We couldn't go because of the pandemic, and it's been put up, and I could find my money, but I couldn't find my wife's money, so I'm on the phone. I'm talking with them. I think I got everything settled. I hang up with a lady. Then I realized I need one more, and I call back, and I got a different lady, and we got to talking. And I said, ma'am, I'm sorry. I feel like I'm being redundant. I was just on the phone, but I said, at the time all this was happening, my wife had COVID, was in the hospital, and, you know, I'm just telling her this kind of stuff. And I said, so my mind's about half shot anyway. And she said, well, you know, my cousin, they're debating this week whether she's going to live or they're going to let her die. So what I did was I began to tell her the grace and the mercy of God that brought my wife back from the jaws of death. And the little thing up front said, this phone call may be recorded for training purposes. So I told her something, and I said, are you still there? She said, yes, sir. She's weeping on the other end of the line. And I said, well, I'm going to be praying for you, but listen, can I have prayer for you right now? So somewhere in the recorded records of Southwest Airlines, on their company time, while they're paying a lady, I'm sharing the story of the healing power of Jesus Christ. Ministry is where you find it. If it's on the streets of Savannah feeding the hungry, or wherever it is, if it's on a phone call with an agent, when most of the time they don't give you nothing but a runaround. But this time God gave me an opportunity. I may not be the person you would look to. You wouldn't dial me up on the switchboard in Washington, but you see, if there's a little young lady somewhere out in Texas that needed to hear that Jesus heals, praise God, the Lord knows who to reveal himself to. He knows how to make hope come where hope doesn't exist. Woo! Hallelujah. It was to a little group of nobodies from nowhere that the angels announced. And for most of us, if we follow what Paul said, we're just a group of nobodies from nowhere, but God took somewhere and made somebodies out of us so that we could tell the world sin has been overcome, Satan has been defeated, death has lost its sting, and eternal life is available in the presence of God because Jesus, the light and the hope of the world, has come. Could somebody give him praise in this house? Whew. They came, they saw, they told, they left, and they rejoiced. Who could believe them? I could. You know, I was thinking, you'll learn this one day when you get old and you preached 4,500 sermons, that when you preach, about half of them come to your mind while you're preaching. I don't know how I want to say this. I'm nobody. But I believe. I believe the words of the shepherds, the words of the wise men. I believe in that belief. The Bible says it is an anchor that extends beyond the veil and holds for me. Now this is, boy, I told Barry to come up today. I said, Pastor Brandon must have really wanted a coastal church because he got as close to the water as he could get here. But you people being here know this, that when you see a ship, the anchor on a ship is not on the rear. Am I right? You put the anchor on the bow of the ship. And if it's a sea anchor and you're anchored down in a storm, you want that anchor on the front. Because what happens when you fish or anything else, if you anchor, you put the anchor on the front because that's the bent part or the bowed part of the boat, and it's made to face the waves. If you can get a big ship in harbor and put the big sea anchor down solid, let the wind come, it will turn the ship to face the storm. And the cut and the bow and the shape of that ship, if it's anchored good, will ride the storms. You don't anchor both ends down. It's got to become able to go up and down with the ebb and flow that comes against it. And let me tell you, the Bible said that we have an anchor. It's not behind me. My anchor is ahead. The Holy Ghost right now. The Bible said that I am looking unto Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of my faith. I'm not hanging on to what's behind me. I'm going to face the storm holding on to the hope that extends into the very presence of Almighty God for me. It is my anchor. I've got light. And I've got hope. And I've got that because I have a Lord. When the king, that was Herod, when they departed from him, who said, "Oh, tell me where he is. I want to worship him too, you liar. You want to kill him." They saw the star and it went before them. Again, I don't know if it's planets. It almost sounds like it was moving, doesn't it? It went before them, it came to the house where he was, and they went in. And when they saw them, they went in, they saw the child, they saw his mother, they fell down. You know what the word worship, you know what worship means? It means to bow down and kiss the hand or kiss the foot. Think of the lady, the lady of ill repute. They came into Simon, the priest or the Pharisee's home, and Jesus was there reclining on the ground, on the floor, sitting. I read the scripture, and she said she wet his feet with her tears, and she was behind him. I thought, now that would have been a job. But it wasn't, because he wasn't sitting in a stool or a chair. He's sitting on the floor with his legs curled up underneath him like I do when I go to a restaurant. I can't sit with both feet on the floor. I put one up under him. His feet were behind him. So she's behind him, and she's weeping on him. She's crying over his dirty feet. And kissing them. say what you will, that was worship. Our God is a sovereign God. Jesus Christ did not come to be your best buddy. And He is my friend. But I, in my life, I'm in an organization. I'm in the Church of God. We have leaders. And a lot of the boys that grew up with me ended up in great leadership positions. And now look, when I was in public with Martin Taylor, I called him Mart. I called him on the phone one day. I didn't know he had his whole staff in there, and they were all scared of him. It was Bishop this and Bishop that and Bishop this. I called him. I said, "Hey, Mart, I need you to do so and so and so and so and so." And his staff said, he said, "Don't pay him no attention. We friends from a long time back." But now, if I was in a setting like this, I would say, he was my state bishop. Good to have my bishop here with me. I'd do that. I would honor that, and I'd lift him up. So, but anyway, Jesus is there, and his feet's there, and she's crying over them. But our God is a sovereign Lord. And I read something one time. Where the Bible says heaven is His throne and earth is His footstool. If you dig down deep enough, you will find in studying a sovereign. You know what it means to be sovereign, a sovereign Lord? It means He owns it all. It means the cattle of 1,000 hills are His, and all the taters that are in the hills, they're His. Jesus Christ did not come to be your friend. I know how to be friends with someone, but I also know how to give honor to whom honor is due. I know how to respect them. Jesus is my friend. He walks with me. He talks with me. But there are times when I bow before Him. A sovereign is a ruler with a throne and a footstool. So when the Bible said heaven is His throne, that's where He's sitting. But the earth is His footstool. That means that's where we bow to worship Him as Lord. This earth is nothing more than a proving and training ground for the day that we walk down streets of gold to the center of that celestial city that is called heaven. Oh, my gracious God. Eye hath not seen, ear has not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things that God hath prepared for them that love Him. But those things are being revealed to us by His Spirit, which He has given us. There's a city that's 1,500 miles high, wide and long. In the center, there is a throne and upon... Oh, God, I feel Him today. On the midst of that throne, there sits the Lamb. And behind Him, there is an emerald green rainbow. And all around Him, there are sapphires and amethyst and rubies and diamonds. And the foundations and the streets are made of translucent gold. And that baby that was born in the manger by candlelight that night is going to sit upon the throne, and there'll be no need of a candle. There'll be no need of a spotlight, for the Lamb of God is the light thereof. Oh, hallelujah. And His glory, He shines like a burning red sardis stone. And as we bow before Him, the light that's coming from that throne will hit the golden streets and the pearly gates and the various different jewels of that city, and there'll be such a display of light that the world has never seen, and we will bow before Him and cast our crowns at His feet and declare that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Somebody give Him praise in this place. There's these kings and priests and rulers bowing. Herod despised Him and wanted to kill Him. Later, the nation would reject Him. But on this night, kings and princes bowed. I pray that on this day, when Washington rejects Him, when so much of our governmental structure is set against Him, that once again, kings and priest, not established by a ministry or an organization, but those who said, "You shall reign with me as kings and priest unto our God. Oh, God, help me. I pray that on this Christmas before, Sunday before, that kings and priests will bow their heads before Him and lift their hands in His presence and worship Him who is born King of the Jews. But you know what? He didn't come to be just king of an insignificant country the size of New Jersey. No, that's not. You see, if you go to Israel, have you ever been? You need to go. Not yet. That's a good way to say it. That's faith. You got have a yet praise. I've been there. I've been to Megiddo. I've been where the great battle of Armageddon is going to take place. I've been to Israel. And Israel, I've been to Jerusalem. And Jerusalem is in the Iron Valley. If you're coming from Egypt or from Africa to Europe, you got to go through the Iron Valley if you're taking a land route. When you get to Megiddo, there's a valley that leads off toward Europe, one that leads off toward Asia. In other words, what I'm telling you is Israel is the crossroads of the ancient world. That's the reason God put up a temple there. That's the reason He said, get me some Levites who can sing and put them in my temple and let them sing 24 hours a day. You think praise and worship on Sunday morning is tough. They did it for 24 hours a day. They wanted everybody that passed by there. The message needs to get out that the Lord God omnipotent reigns forever and forever. Hey, they sang the glories of God, and we have been made the kings and priests, and we've been sent as missionaries to this entire world to tell the story. Buddha won't do. Muhammad won't get you there. Confucius doesn't have the answer, but Jesus Christ is the light of the world. He's the hope of glory, and He's the Lord of all. Somebody give Him praise one more time. I'm closing. I ain't preached that long. And don't argue with me. Isaiah said it this way: for unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. He's not mommy God. He's not she. He's God the Father. I don't know why He chose it that way, but that's what He said. Somebody said, well, God said it. I believe it. No matter whether you believe it or not, it is. And He sent His Son. A son is given. And the government should be upon His shoulder. And His name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of His government and peace, there will be no end. You know, United States is a very young country. And right now, I'll be honest with you, I believe the very foundations of our democratic and government are being threatened in this world today. Our liberties are being snatched away from us from all sides. I'm not throwing dirt at one party. I'm telling you, our government is trying to repress this society and put it in a situation where it can't be, but we're only a little over 200 years old. There are kingdoms that have far outlasted what we've done. But there is coming a kingdom of which I am a part. We look unto heaven, from whence the Bible says, if you got the King James Version, it says our conversation is from heaven. But that conversation doesn't mean the way you talk. It means your citizenship. Your citizenship is in heaven. I'm a citizen of two worlds. I hold dual citizenship. I'm an American and proud of it. I'm American by birth and Southern by the grace of God. But I'm an American. But I'm also, my name is recorded in heaven. And as I'm in this world, I am also an ambassador for my heavenly kingdom. He will establish it with judgment and justice from this time forward, even forever, and the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform it. And let everybody who wants to defy it, let them deny it, let them say it's stuff, let them say it's lunacy, let them say what they want to. One day, this little baby that grew up into a man was crucified on a cross, buried in a borrowed tomb, and resurrected again, and ascended to heaven in the sight of hundreds. It's coming back. One day the governments of this world shall fall. The kingdoms of this world shall fall. Therefore, God has highly, Paul said this, exalted him and given him a name. No, you don't pronounce it the same everywhere. If you're Hebrew, it's Yeshua. If you're Arab, it's Isa. If you're English, it's Jesus. And I guess you could go through a whole list and somebody said, well, you got to say it this way. No, all you got to do is say it. It is the hope of the world in a word. How many times have you prayed this prayer? Jesus! That's all you said. Jesus! It's the hope of the world in a word. Every knee shall bow. Those in heaven, those on the earth, and those under the earth. And every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. In Revelation 19 and 16, when he's coming back to take over, he's riding on a white horse. An old preacher one time got the opportunity to see one of the space capsules. I've seen the space shuttle. I was in the harbor when the space shuttle took off one day, and I didn't know. I was on a cruise ship, and I didn't know the space shuttle was taking off. And that huge cruise vessel began to shake. I ain't never felt such power. I lived in Winter Haven, and one night I watched a blast at night. We were 60 miles from the coast, and I watched that thing. It lit the whole sky. That's fascinating. But a preacher was there for one of the space capsules that went up. And a man said, that's mighty amazing, isn't it, sir? He said, yeah, but I'm going to tell you one better than that. That's powerful. I can't imagine the power of that Atlas rocket taking that thing off here. But he said, I'm going to tell you one day I'm going to leave here on a cloud. And then I'm coming back riding a white horse. The guy looked at him like he's crazy. But he don't know what we know. Yeah. We don't know that when he comes back, he'll have on a robe and on his thigh will be a name written King of Kings. He's not just a king. If you got all the kings of the world together in one room, who'd rule them? He would. He's the King of Kings. All the lords. He's Lord of Lords. Who is he? Let me tell you this, and we're going to go into the finishing part of this service. Who is this babe? He's Jesus, the Son of God, the light of the world. And may that light continue to shine in us. He's Jesus, sweetest name ever spoken, the hope of the world in a word. And he's Jesus. He is Lord. Not only Lord of all the kingdoms of this world, but I come to report to you today, he's Lord of all the kingdoms of my heart. No wonder Handel wrote, and he shall reign forever and ever. Hallelujah. 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 Would you lift your hands toward heaven and bless him?